this morning, we had a wonderful time here on Friday. Barbecue at Pasir Ris Park. Almost 80 of us, I think. Adults and children. And we had a lot of food to eat. For the first time in my life that I see so much of fruits. Bought from Pontian, Malaysia. Big prawn, sweet potato, and all kind of things. But most of all, I think the fellowship is very important, and we hope that in future we can, at least every year, we have a fellowship like that as a church. Thank you all for contributing. Thank you all for helping in this church outing. Thank you also for praying for us. We had a wonderful time, a successful ministry on the mountain of Chiang Mai. And this sermon this morning is actually done on the mountain. So thank you for praying for me and the team. Okay, and today we shall continue the expositions of the Gospel according to Matthew. In Matthew chapter 12, which was preached last week by Deacon Zhihong, we heard that people continue to reject Jesus and Jesus denounced their disbelief. Here in chapter 13, Jesus uses parables to separate his kingdom in two ways. This morning will be internally, he separate that. That is from verse 1 to verse 23. Externally means that in this world, in the world as a context. And next Sunday, Deacon Chiong will come back to preach from verses 24 to 53, the rest of chapter 13. Then the king separate his kingdom internally, meaning in the church itself. Okay, so that will be next Sunday. Separate means differentiate. Differentiate who is who in his kingdom. Now, just like we have in Singapore, we have the citizen and non-citizen, and we also have the PR, the permanent residents. In school, we have a streaming system to identify students with academic potentials. Yeah? And at our workplace, for those who are working, we have a ranking system to identify good workers for promotion and also for reward. Now, many of us will hope to find our names in the list of people who have potential to advance in our studies and also in our career. Now, I still remember when I was still serving in the army, the unhappy faces of my colleagues who did not make the cut. Some blame the system of being biased to the scholars. You know, in the army we have scholar and farmer. Scholar means those people who have degree. Farmer, that means No, those are lowly educated. Some have no heart to work after that. Some resign and go somewhere else for better prospect. So in life, when we are being categorized as not having potential for study or for career promotion, we will feel terrible, isn't it? Yes or no? But what about being categorized as not in the kingdom of God? In other words, having no hope of salvation, no hope of eternal life. That means when you die, that's it. And there will be no promotion to glory. Now, have you ever thought about that? In Matthew chapter 12, when the people rejected Jesus and his teaching, he said to them in verse 30, "Whoever not with me is against me. And whoever does not gather with me scatters. Now Jesus is making a differentiation here. If we are not working with Him, we are not working with Jesus, we are actually working against Him. That is what He means. We are either in or out of His list of names who will live forever with Him in heaven. In or out. There is no in between. So the message this morning is very important. Please pay careful attention. In this passage, chapter 3, verse 1 to 23, the seed in the parable is the message of God, the gospel of Jesus Christ. And the four soils are the responses. Now we will learn that the type of soil determines the destiny of our souls. Whether we are in or out of God's kingdom. First, let us look at the parable and the meaning. Because Jesus Christ tells them the parable and then He explained the meaning of the parable. The seeds are God's messengers. Where are God's messengers come from? From the Bible, of course, from the preaching of His word. But God also speaks to us through His creation, through circumstances in life. So God, listen carefully, God is speaking to all people all the time to call people to believe in His Son, Jesus Christ, and to have a relationship with Him. God never created heaven and earth, put His image that the human being on earth and then forget about them. Continue to speak to us. God is creator. Creator God is a God of revelation. But the success of getting people to believe in Jesus Christ depends on the receptivity of those who hear. Now what are you doing now? You are hearing the word of God being preached to you. So the receptivity of those who hear what He is saying to them is the determining factor. Now first, the hard soil in verse 4 and 19. Hard soil won't receive the gospel. Can you switch off this light? Okay. I hope you can see me. Okay, as I said that the sermon is done in Bangkok. Okay, all this picture actually taken there as I walk around the mission house and I see this thing and take it out. Hard soil. The seed falls on the path. You look at the path of the picture. As you can see on the screen there, it is a hard path. Where people, you can see two people there, walk and they will trample on the seed. Just imagine if you throw the seed on this path. Now if not, you look at the chicken down there. Is there a chicken there?
No.
Okay. The bird will pick it up. So in verse 19, Jesus tells us that the bird is like the evil one, Satan, takes the seed, the gospel seed, away. So the gospel is not received at all. No reception. Just like your handful. Nothing happened. When the gospel is preached to people whose hearts are hardened in sin, it makes no impression. Isn't that true? It is like the seed on the hard path. It is easily ignored or taken away and never allowed to take root. Now, like the religious leaders of Jesus' day, they already have their own gods. They trust in their own belief system. The Jews believed in obeying the law of Moses to be saved. Now today, We also have many people trust in their own belief system. They trust in the ability to live their lives and build their own kingdom instead of looking to Jesus. Some cling on to traditional beliefs and practices. Some say that religion cannot mix and Christianity is believing in a Western God. Now even I told them that Jesus came neither from the East nor West, but Middle East. They will say no. Hard soil will say to Jesus. Hard soil will say no to Jesus from the onset. So are you a hard soil? Have you encountered such people? So this is the first kind of response. No reception. Another kind of response is the rocky soil. You can see on the screen how the gospel seed falls on a rocky soil. It's like it grows, but it is so small that you can't see it. Can you see it? Cannot see it. Okay, let's enlarge it. Okay, now you can see. This is the enlarged view. Now take a closer look. Jesus said in verses 5 to 6, the rocky ground has little soil, no depth, so it cannot grow much and cannot take the heat of the sun and will eventually die. And he explained in verses 20 to 21, these rocky soil are those who hear the gospel. For example, in the gospel rally, and they see it as something new and pleasing, and it offers them peace, pardon, salvation, and a religion to cling on. Not bad. So as they imagine that they are pardoned, it produces a certain kind of peace and joy. So they are for a time happy because their anxious feelings are subsiding. They are emotionally healed, so-called. But there is no ground of permanent joy. That is the problem. Because there is no true repentance. There is no true pardon. No real love for Jesus, the Savior, who died for their sins. There is no spiritual strength to resist temptation. So in times of trial and persecution, their joy subsides and fall away. Listen carefully. The rocky soil are not true Christians. Their hearts are not changed and their life have not surrendered to Jesus Christ. Who are the people in danger of falling into this category of soil? The festival Christians. They appear in church during special occasions like Easter, Christmas, or they appear for the Lord's Supper just to console themselves that they are Christian. They receive God's messages intermittently, here and there, like taking buffet. They do not have the full picture of God and salvation, and they do not have real confidence in God, and they are little. An unsteady spiritual strength is insufficient to sustain them when trials come. So rocky soil is problematic. But there is yet another problematic soil called the thorny soil. Verse 7 and 22. Verse 7 tells us the gospel seed is choked by the thorns, just like the dried up plant. In the picture on the screen, you can see the dried up plant standing right in the middle of all the thorns that grow together with him. The love, Jesus explained in verse 22 that thorns are the cares, the anxieties, and the deceitful lure of riches and wealth that interferes the growth of the seed. The love for the world leaves no room for Jesus. These people take so much time and pay so much attention to the things in life that they leave no opportunity to examine and to care for their own souls. Their soul is never satisfied. Their soul never at peace. On the other hand, the desire to possess more wealth, more money, get them into trouble. Money is important. And we all must make money. But the love of money is causing the destructions of God's work. As we see in 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 9 to 10. Let me read to you. But those who desire to be rich fall into temptation, into a snare, into many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. Verse 10. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. It is through this craving for money that some have wandered away from faith. Wandered away. And pierced themselves with many pangs. So you see, in pursuing more wealth, listen very carefully, there is every temptation to be dishonest, to cheat, to take advantage of others, to oppress others, especially the poor and the helpless. When we fall in love with this world, every evil scheme will creep into our hearts, will creep into our life. It is no wonder that the word of God is choked and every good feeling destroyed. Many are foolishly drawn themselves in destruction as they allow their minds to be filled with materialism, allowing their soul to be deceived by the empty promise of joy and happiness. And finally, they are left naked and guilty and lost. We can easily find thorny soil in Singapore, isn't it? Chasing after money, fame, and glory. And we are so stressed that we lost the essence of life. Let me tell you a story. A group of highly educated students visited their old university professor. Conversation soon turned into complaints about stress in work, stress in life. Offering them coffee, the professor returned from the kitchen with a pot of freshly brewed coffee and an assortment of cups, porcelain, glass, crystal, some plain looking, some expensive, and some exquisite, telling them to help themselves with the coffee. When all had a cup of coffee in hand, the professor said, "And if you guys have noticed, all the nice-looking expensive cups were taken out, leaving behind the plain ones. While it is normal for you to want only the best, that is also the source of your stress. What you really want was coffee, not the cup. But you still went for the best cup and were eyeing each other's cups. If life is coffee, then jobs, money, and status in society is the cup. They are just tools to hold and contain life. So don't let the cups drive you. Enjoy your coffee. Are you one of them who care more about the cups than the coffee? How do you know? Just count the amount of time and energy you put in the things you do every day. What is causing you stress? Do you still have time for the Word of God? How often you read the Word of God? How often you open the Bible and read? What is competing for your attentions in life? Jesus? Can you remember who are you? what are you here for on earth? As you can see, the gospel has no opportunity to survive in the above three types of soil. They won't live for Jesus. They don't belong to Jesus. They won't work with Jesus when they work against Jesus. But the gospel will thrive in a kind of soil called the good soil. Verses 8, 9, and verse 23. Now you can identify this soil easily because it is marked by productivity. The key ingredient of a good soil is understanding the gospel. As mentioned by Jesus in verse 23, Jesus said, "As for what was sown on good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it." Hear the word and understands it. What does it mean? It means a heart, listen carefully, which means a heart not only fully receive the gospel but also hunger for God and His righteousness. Why? Because the eternal value of this gospel is understood. So he will take action to cultivate it, to give it full opportunity to grow deep and become fruitful. You look at the picture, you look at this tree just in front of the mission house. As I look at it, wow, it is so fruitful. And I look at the soil, wow, the soil is really fertile. It is like a successful conceptions in the womb of a married woman. The gospel gave birth to a new life in good soil that has the potential of multiplying more new lives. Jesus continued in verse 23b. He said, "He," referring to the good soil, "he indeed bears fruits and yields in one case 100-fold, in another 60, and in another 30. It means in due time, after receiving the gospel seed, the good soil will bear two types of fruits. First is a spiritual fruit. Like in Galatians chapter 5, 22-24, let me read to you. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. And those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires." Godly characters grow in the good soil, while the sinful passion and desire of the flesh dies, crucified in Christ. What does it mean? It means life change. Second, fruits is that they will also be spreading the good news to others, using their lives in multiplying heavenly blessing instead of filling their lives with cares and anxieties of the world. Healthy tree will grow healthy fruit. They live their life responsibly, in other words, and make it useful to the kingdom of God in bringing more people to believe in Jesus. Good soil people live intentionally with a heart exposes fully to the influence of God's truth. I like to imagine this way, like a broad and fertile land, openly welcoming the sunshine and the rain from heaven, and then reproducing great number of fruits, 100-fold, 64, 30-fold. So the lesson for us is this: the gospel can only grow fruitfully in good soil. The gospel can only grow fruitfully in good soil. So what soil are you? Let me ask you, will you jump for joy if you are a good soil? Will you be greatly saddened if you are not? Like the ranking exercise. Whatever category you belong, my dear friends, brothers and sisters, please pay attention to the purpose of the parable. Now we come to the purpose of the parable. Give the reason for using parable. When the disciple asked him why he used parable to teach, listen carefully. In verse 11, Jesus says, people in New Testament time, like you and me, are given the privilege of knowing the secret of kingdom of heaven. What is that? That is no secret to us. Okay. But it is revealed to us the gospel of Christ. Because it is Christ who come that bring in the era of the New Testament when God's promise is fulfilled. God's promise to send the Savior, the Messiah, is fulfilled. You see, the Old Testament prophet, they don't understand fully how the suffering and the glory of the Savior will be fulfilled. So therefore, the people in the Old Testament time did not have the advantage of a full view of Jesus and His work on the cross. Just like my grandparents, they did not have the privilege of seeing and using a headphone. They only know that if you want to make a phone, you must go to a fixed point. But if you were to tell them, give them a headphone and say that you can make a call everywhere, anywhere, they will tell them no way. So this is a privilege for the New Testament people like us, knowing that Christ died for us in order to save us. But Jesus says in verse 12 that when this gospel is preached, there are two potential outcomes. He said, for the one who has, more will be given, and he will have an abundance. But from the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away. What does it mean? Those who believe in Jesus will be given even more benefits of the gospel. That's what it means. Those who reject Jesus will lose what they have, referring to the Jews, who have the opportunity to study the Old Testament. They seem to have or think that they have God's truth. But if they don't recognize Jesus Christ as the Savior, they will lose it eventually. They will lose the whole truth of God. That's why Jesus said, even what he has will be taken away. Means you lose it. Refers to inferior or insufficient knowledge of the gospel, or don't engage it and fully understand the meaning, they will eventually lose it. In spite of Jesus speaking to them personally, you see, as you all have heard last Sunday, they reject him. Can you imagine that God incarnate standing in front of them and speak to them and tell them that I'm going to die for you, for your sin, so that you can live? And they reject him. Finally, in verse 13, Jesus tells us the purpose for using parable is to expose those who are spiritually blind. He said, because seeing, they do not see, and hearing, they do not hear. nor do they understand. You see, they don't understand. They don't get it. Those who hear the parable, they understand the natural meaning of the things, of the story, but not the spiritual significance. Hearing, not hearing. Seeing, not seeing. Now, just like in Matthew 12, when they saw Jesus perform the miracle of healing a man who was blind, mute, and demon-possessed, three in one, they said Jesus borrowed Satan's power to cast out the demon. Matthew 12:24. See, but when the Pharisees heard it, heard about this miracle of healing and cast out the demon, he said it is only the Beelzebub, the prince of demons, that this man cast out demons. They simply do not take Jesus seriously. Let me ask you, do you take Jesus seriously? In what way do you take him seriously? Do you take Jesus as serious, as likely as these people? Parable of the four soil exposes those who have no love for God's truth. Jesus says they are condemned and doomed, as prophesied in Isaiah chapter 6. So verse 14 and 15, this is the prophecy of Isaiah quoted by Jesus Christ. You will indeed hear, but never understand. And you will indeed see, but never perceive. For this people's heart has grown dull, and with their ears they can barely hear, and their eyes they have closed, lest they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their heart and turn, and I would heal them. They do not understand the spiritual implication, so they do not turn to God for healing, and they are condemned eternally. This is a serious warning. This applies to us also. In our responsive reading from Acts chapter 28, verse 17 to 27, we read this morning. You see, when the Jews do not believe in the gospel preached to them, Paul quotes the same prophecy from Isaiah to condemn them. On the other hand, those who receive Jesus are blessed. In verse 16 and 17, Jesus says, but blessed are your eyes, for they see, and your ears, for they hear. For truly I say to you, many prophets and righteous people long to see what you see and did not see it, and long to hear what you hear and did not hear it. Blessed are those who see and heard clearly the gospel, understood correctly and fully, and take it as life-giving and soul-penetrating message from God. Jesus said to his followers that they are more favored than the most honored people like the prophet and kings. Let me read to you Luke chapter 10, verse 23 and 24. Then turn to the disciples, he said privately, but exclusively he told them, blessed are the eyes that see what you see. For I tell you that many prophets and kings desired to see what you see and did not see, and to hear what you hear and did not hear it. You see, prophets and kings are not as favored, as privileged as you guys. So if you are a good soil, rejoice, because we can understand fully how the suffering and the glory of the Savior Jesus Christ is fulfilled in His first coming. And we also given the privilege of the in the scripture that how His second coming will be fulfilled. You see, when the gospel becomes our treasure, we are the blessed. We become the good news as we live in this good news. So lesson for us is that our response to the gospel has far-reaching implications. Why? Because we were either condemned or blessed eternally. Eternally. You see, there is one message, but two destinies. Therefore, there is no such thing as a backsliding Christian. We either believe in Jesus or we don't. We may give any name, all kind of name, to a person who does not live like a Christian. But as far as God is concerned, God knows exactly what is in our hearts. He knows who reject Jesus. He knows who accept Him. So in conclusion, the parable exposes the conditions of the hearts of the people in the world. Whether we prefer Jesus or we prefer something else, the hard soil, the rocky soil, the thorny soil are the people who reject Jesus, as their responses confirm it. If you are in this category, if you belong to one of these three types of soil, I urge you to go to Jesus quickly. Tomorrow may be too late. The truth for life. For those who believe in Jesus, whose heart is a good soil, the goodness of the gospel is embedded in our heart and manifested in our life. For the good soil, the kingdom of God has come. So we can praise the Lord for that. God is looking for good soil to plant the gospel seed. That is why Jesus said in verse 9, He who has ears, let him hear. We must not let anything to stop us from coming to true faith in Jesus Christ. Do something about it. If your heart is hard or rocky, soften your heart. If your heart is full of thorns, remove them so that the good news of God can rest in your heart. Take good care of your soul. Don't worry about the cups, enjoy the coffee. If your soul is a good soil, make it better and spread the gospel to more people. Why? There are still good soil around. There are still people desperately looking for salvation, waiting for you, Christian, to sow the gospel seed. We have two applications this morning. First, don't be discouraged if you see not many people come to believe in Christ, even you try. Remain faithful in sowing the gospel seed. According to a survey on religion in Singapore conducted in 2010, Buddhism 33%, Christianity 18%, no religions or humanists 17%, Islam 15%, Taoism 11%, Hinduism 5.1%, Sikhism, Judaism, and others 0.9%. In other words, there are 82% of the population in Singapore are not responding to Jesus Christ, whom God the Father has sent 2,000 years ago, died on the cross of Calvary, and declare the pardon for everybody. So you know what is at stake. 82% may be lost eternally. So teachers, preachers, parents, like Isaiah and like Apostle Paul, who would still preach God's message, who would still preach the gospel of Jesus Christ in spite of gloomy prospect. Christ wants us to do all we can until He comes. Christ wants us to work hard to help people to understand the message and pray for them. That is the first thing that we must do. The second thing that we must do is to improve the quality of our soil so that we can reproduce more. Now, how to improve your growth? The only way to go up is to go deep. You heard about this before, right? So there are 5 steps for us to take in order to really understand the Word of God. As I said just now, understanding of God's message is very key to good growth. It's the key to fruitfulness. Listen carefully to the 5 steps that I'm going to introduce to you. Number 1, hear. Have a positive attitude of wanting to be fed with the Word of life. You know, preachers spend great amount of time and effort to prepare the messages. So pay attention. Don't go to sleep when I preach. However, hearing from preaching is not enough. You must be like the Berea Jewish Christian, who not only eager to hear, but also daily check the Bible themselves. In Acts chapter 17, verse 11, this is what Dr. Liu recorded. Now, these Jews were more noble than those in Thessalonica. Because in Thessalonica, many people turn to Christ are Gentile. Okay, the Jews in Thessalonica were very passive. But the Jews here, they received in Berea, they received the word with all eagerness. You look at the word, all eagerness. And they don't stop there. Examine the scripture daily to see if this thing was so. So when they hear, they don't stop there. They go back and check it out. Okay? So the second step is to read the Bible. The Bible is God's sermons for us. The Bible can be understood by everybody. Because it is God's sermon for us. So when you read the Bible yourself, God speaks to you directly. And you can do it at your own time, own place. And you can let God deal with the changing situation in your own life. Don't you think it is a privilege to hear God speaking to you directly? Don't you think so? Since it is God speaking, it carries His authority and it carries His power. Now, hearing and reading are good, but to go deep, we must study. We must study. Okay, the Bible, we must study the Bible so that we can get a thorough understanding of the Word and ask God, the Spirit, through prayer, read and pray, to help us make the picture clearer. Don't you want to have a clear picture or very fuzzy and unclear? You see, spiritual things need spiritual help. And the only help, the best teacher that you can find is the Holy Spirit. So when we have done the first 3 steps, hearing, reading, and studying, we have something precious, something powerful in hand. So don't stop there. But store up so that you can use it, so that you can experience the power of God. How? 2 more steps. By memorizing and meditating on it. Memorize. Psalmist 119 verse 11 is saying, the psalmist says, I have stored up your word in my heart, that I might not sin against you. See, word of God is the sword of the spirit stored in our hearts and mind as weapon against enemies' attack. When tempted by the devil, Jesus rebuked him with what? With God's word. He quoted Old Testament. To know how to use God's word in our situation, we need to meditate. Meditation means reviewing the Bible verses that we memorize and pray to God to show us how we can put these verses into practice in our life. For example, sin to avoid, commands to obey, promise of God to claim. You see, before Joshua led the Israelites to fight and to conquer the promised land, God told him to meditate. To meditate on His word. He said, the books of the law shall not depart from your mouth, Joshua, but you shall meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do according to all that is written in it. In other words, God will tell him what to do. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. Not just success, but good success. Truth. If truth is not applied, it is not true. So it is through applying of God's truth in our life, in our daily situation, that our faith in Christ is displayed and strengthened. I have this experience just wondrous at the time. For example, Psalm 23 verse 1. I think if I ask tell you Psalm 23 verse 1, everybody will know, right? The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. You see, this word, this verse has such a magical power on me. Because if I remember God is my shepherd, who is holy, who is all powerful, who is all loving and lacking nothing, then I, as His sheep, will lack nothing, will fear nothing, isn't it? The relationship of the sheep and the shepherd makes me strong in difficult situations because I have the love and the care of a great shepherd who will never give me up. So my dear brothers and sisters in Christ, starting today, open your hearts fully to God's truth and hunger for more. Through hearing, reading, studying, memorizing, and meditating on it. And I assure you, God will be pleased to give you more abundant fruitfulness in your life. Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for speaking to us, telling us how your beloved Son has been rejected, how the hearts of people have been exposed. Lord, forgive us the time that we also neglect your word. The time also, Lord, that we have lost the focus of what is really important in life. We see, seeing but we do not see. Hearing, but we hear not. Forgive us. Lord, we pray, dear Lord, that you will help us to fight this spiritual battle, especially our spiritual blindness. Grant us the spiritual eyes to be able to see the wonderful thing that Lord, you have created and provided. Cause us to be able to understand that are daily speaking to us through your word, through circumstances. Also ask not to be so self-absorbed, self-centered, and myopic. That, Lord, we couldn't even see the big picture, the wonderful creation, the wonderful salvation in and through Jesus Christ. In His name we pray.